Hello and good afternoon, friends. Welcome to the CEC EDUSET live lecture. As we always promised and try to bring for you new topics, but for the topic which we are going to talk about and we are going to discuss about is a topic which we have been discussing since 2 days, and that is on the morphology. Yesterday we talked about the concept of a geomorphical cycle, and with this very concept we talked about the Davis concept of geomorphical cycle. Today also we are going to discuss some more new cycles, and those new cycles are of L.C. King, Walther Pank and J.T. Hack. And for this we have with us again in our studios Dr. Abhay Kumar. He is associated with the Institute for Human Development, and he has been working on the various topics, various concepts such as on regional development as well as population and development issues. So first of all, I would like to welcome Dr. Abhay Kumar in this EDUSET lecture of ours, and would like him to tell more about the various concepts which he is going to discuss today in this EDUSET lecture of ours.
Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon, friends. As you know, yesterday I discussed about the Davisian concept of geomorphic cycle, and today I am going to discuss about the concept of geomorphic cycle given by Walther Pank, L.C. King and J.T. Hack, when we will discuss different concepts. But before I start, let me recap what we have discussed about the Davisian concept of geomorphic cycle. As you recall, yesterday I discussed about the geomorphic cycle of William Morris Davis, wherein he has given a cyclical concept of landscape development. And in that particular process, you know, I have discussed how erosional cycle progresses from youth to maturity to old stage, and each of the stages are characterized by different landforms, and each of the stages have different kind different erosional features. As you know, while critically evaluating the theory or the concept of the geomorphic cycle given by Davis, we discussed that Davisian concept was, though very famous and one of the most innovative, but it was criticized on number of counts, and chief among those are: one, that landscape development and erosional surfaces, according to Davis, goes one by one. So first landscape or upliftment of landmass takes place, and thereafter erosional processes starts. Whereas later on it was criticized that landscape upliftment of the landmass as well as the erosional processes both go hand in hand. It doesn't, one doesn't wait for the other. So in that particular case, I briefly discussed about Walther Pank and his criticism on the Davisian concept of geomorphic cycle. Now I will discuss about the morphological analysis given by Walther Pank, in which I will discuss how he criticized Davis and he has given his own concept of, you know, morphology. To begin with, let me tell you that yesterday also I gave you a brief background of Walther Pank, but today again I am recapping those things. Walther Pank was a German geologist, and he couldn't live his entire life. In his early life, he has worked a lot on the geology and geomorphological concepts, and he has written number of papers and books, but most of his writings are in German language and in very tough German language, which was very difficult to be, you know, translated. Later on it got translated by Chick and Boswell in 1953, though he gave his theory of morphology our morphology analysis, which was called as dimorphological analysis, which was given in 1924, which means that it was an analysis or the morphological analysis of landforms. This particular version of morphological analysis was later on translated in 1953 by Check and Boswell. The difference between Peng and Davis was largely the approach of Davis was geographical, or you can say geomorphological, whereas the Peng's approach was largely geological. So there they differed in the approach of analyzing the morphology of the landscape, whereas the cyclical concept or the time dependent concept of Davis cycle of Davis concept of morphological analysis, geomorphological cycle was refuted, and he has given his own time independent concept of morphological analysis. Main goal of Peng's model of morphological system was to find out the mode of development and cause of crustal movement on the basis of exogenetic processes and morphological characteristics. So basically there were two major things which was the aim of Peng's to discover. One was the mode of development of the crustal movement, or you know, the upliftment of the landmass, and also the processes that are that were working on that. Earth's surface, according to Peng, was regarded as a zone of conflict, wherein there is a continuous struggle between the external and internal forces. By external and internal forces, Peng meant that external forces are exogenetic forces, and by internal forces, it meant that it is endogenetic forces. So both exogenetic forces and endogenetic forces, they were continuously competing each other, you know, having a conflict with each other, and the landscape formation is a result of this particular conflict. To discuss his concept in detail, he has based his concept on certain premises. According to him, the morphological characteristics of any region is a result of competition between endogenetic and exogenetic processes, which I just discussed, that it is a continuous, you know, competition. There is a competition going on between the exogenetic factors and endogenetic factors, and as a result of this competition, the any region gets its morphological characteristics, or any region gets its landscape formation. Because now his concept was time independent. Peng didn't bound this particular competition of endogenetic and exogenetic processes within a time frame, what Davis was trying to make. Davis was trying to make his erosional cycle in a fixed time frame, in a closed time frame, whereas Peng was making his concept in a time independent frame. Thirdly, tectonic movement and their crustal factors can be explained on the basis of morphological characteristics. So if you see the morphological characteristics of any region, you can discuss about the tectonic movement and their causal factors. Also, one of Peng's major contribution is on the hill slope. He said that the shape of hill slope depends on relative rates of valley incision and removal by river. So how a hill slope is formed, Peng has contributed, you know, in fact it was one of the pioneer contribution made by Peng in this field, wherein he has discussed about the shape of any hill slope, and he said that any shape of hill slope is dependent on the relative rates of valley incision and the amount or the removal of debris by river. So how valley is cutting, or the river is cutting its valley, and also how much debris or how much sediments is being transported by river. So there is a, you know, a relative rate between the two, and as a result of which shape of any hill slope is formed. He said that there are three stages of crustal movements. Penck's, we have seen in Davisian concept that the upliftment of land masses is taking place even before the erosion process starts, and after that there is a constant structural stability, whereas there is no interference and the cycle of erosion completes its full cycle, passing from youth to mature to old age. Whereas Penck has also discussed about the this process of landforms, but his concept was entirely different from Davis. According to him, again there are three stages, of course, but the three stages are different than what Davis suggested. According to him, the first stage, in the first stage, what happens? There is a crustal stability. That means there is not there is no observance of the upliftment of the landmass in the first stage. In the second stage, there are certain initial domes upliftment in a limited area. And as you progress into the third stage, what happens? There is an extensive crustal upliftment. So, according to Penck, the crustal movements passes through three stages, but its passing of the three stages are rather gradual and steady, wherein in the initial stages it is stable. In the second stage, there is a limited upliftment in the forms of domes, and in the third stage, there is an extensive crustal upliftment. So these are the three stages discussed by Penck. Now these three stages, according to Penck, is basically adjustment between crustal movement and valley deepening. So how a crustal movement is taking place and how a river is deepening its valley, it is a outcome of these two processes. So there are three different kind of situation. One, where there is a balance between the rate of upliftment and the rate of erosion. Secondly, where the rate of upliftment is greater than the rate of erosion. And thirdly, there is a rate of upliftment lesser than the rate of erosion. So these are the three different situation under which a crustal development or the landform development takes place. So when there is, and ultimately what happens, the equilibrium is maintained. So there is a continuous process of valley deepening and upliftment of landmass is taking place, but at the end what you find is an equilibrium between the two. And also according to Penck, the crustal movement or the upliftment of the landmass as well as the rate of erosion both goes simultaneously. It does not, one does not wait for another to stop. So both of them go simultaneously. Penck, as I said earlier, he was a German and he has written his concept in German language. So he has used certain typical German terminologies, wherein by different stages he meant and he called Entwicklung. As you can see here, Entwicklung means the stages of development. And he said that there are three different stages of development, as you have seen in the case of Davisian. Though Davis said that it is youth, mature and old, whereas Penck said that it is Obsteigende Entwicklunge, then Gleichformige Entwicklunge, and then Absteigende Entwicklunge. So these are the three different stages Penck tried to explain in German language. And the concept of Penck said that in the case of Davis, we have seen that the erosion surface or the erosional processes starts with a high uplifted landmass, whereas in the case of Penckian concept of geomorphic cycle, he said that in the beginning there is a Primarumpf. Primarumpf is another terminology in German, which means that there is a characteristic landscape before upliftment which is featureless. So Primarumpf is nothing but in the initial stage of the landform development, what happens? There is a featureless plain what Davis envisaged in the last stage. But there is a difference between the Davisian last stage of peneplain and the primer hump of Peng. So we should not confuse between the two. Many of the scholars have also tried to clarify this primer hump with the peneplain, because both of them are meaning same, but one is at the last stage after the erosional processes ends, whereas primer hump is in the initial stage where the in the beginning when the landscape development process has just started. Many of the scholars, for instance Von Engen, Carlos Sauer, these scholars have tried to give another terminology to this primer hump. They called it primary peneplain, but many of the scholars have warned for using this particular terminology, because peneplain is a very different concept and it is the end product of a geomorphic cycle, whereas primer hump is just the beginning or is the first stage of the geomorphic cycle given by Peng. So we should not confuse between the two. Now what peneplain Davis was envisaging in his cycle of geomorphic in his geomorphic cycle, Peng has called it endrumph. So endrumph is the last stage, or you can say the terminal stage of his concept of landform development. But as we know that Davisian peneplain or the last stage was a flat featureless surface, whereas in endrumph what is there, we have a high up, you know, high rise relief. So there is a complete different difference between the end product of the two geomorphic cycle. So in peneplain what we see is a complete plain featureless land, whereas in the cycle given in the concept given by Peng, what we find as an end product is the end ramp, which is the high relief area. Peng postulated that geomorphic forms are an expression of the phase and rate of upliftment in relation to the rate of degradation. As I discussed earlier, that it is, you know, a continuous struggle, and whatever landscape we see is just an expression of the phase and rate of uplift in relation to the rate of degradation or the rate of erosion. As I discussed, that initially it is a slow initial uplift, later on the acceleration of the upliftment starts, and finally there is a deceleration of the uplift, but at the end stage what we find is a endrumph or a quiescence. As we have seen the three different stages of Davis, young, mature and old. Similarly, Peng has also given three stages of the development, and he has called Absteigende Entwicklunge, Gleisförmige Entwicklunge and Absteigende Entwicklunge. Now Absteigende Entwicklunge is a phase of development where there is a waxing rate of landform development. By waxing rate we mean that there is a very fast rate of landform development, and this is indicated by convex slopes. So in this particular stage what you find is the slope of the valley will be of a convex nature, whereas in the and also the characteristics of this particular stage will be a very great increasing intensity of erosion. So Absteigende Entwicklunge will be having a convex slope as well as fast rate of fast rate of erosion. In the second phase, which was Gleisförmige Entwicklunge, in which he said there will be a uniform development and it will be characterized by a constant intensity of erosion, and ultimately we will find a very uniform slope also in this particular stage. So Gleisförmige Entwicklunge is a uniform development of landforms, which is characterized by uniform rate of erosion as well as uniform slope. The third stage of Peng was Absteigende Entwicklunge, where there is a waning development, the rate of development slows down, wherein you find the rate of erosion also slows down, and at the end what you find is the slope of this particular stage will be of a concave nature. And these are the three different stages which Penck envisages in his concept of geomorphic or morphological analysis. However, many of the other scholars were not willing to accept ideas of Penck's, particularly the ideas or the ideas of intensity of erosion, because according to Penck, a rate of erosion is, you know, Penck's ideas, you know, of slopes being determined by intensity of erosion, as they are affected by other factors also, such as lithology, structure, climate, size of debris produced, its mode of transport, etc. So rate of erosion is not only, you know, dependent on the upliftment of the landmass, but it is also dependent on other factors such as lithology, structure, climate, size of debris produced, its mode of transport, etc. But nevertheless, his ideas of on slope were pioneering and attracted the geomorphologists to work further on it. As I said, that Penck made a great analysis on the development of slope, and his ideas of slope was very much pioneering. In fact, he was one of the first person who given the ideas of slope or the concept of slope. And he said that there are two main elements in the valley side slope. One is upper relatively steep, which he called in German language as Bosche or Stillwand. And secondly, he said that there is a lower, more gentler slope, which he called in German language as Haldenhang. So there are two different elements of a valley slope, those two slope elements are Bosche in his language as well as Haldenhang. So Bosche and Haldenhang. Later on, Meyerhoff called, or you can say translated this particular slope into the upper relatively slope, or the Bosche into gravity slope, and the lower more gentler slope or Haldenhang slope as a wash slope. So we know the concept of gravity slope and wash slope, which was for the first time developed by Walter Penck in his analysis of the morphology. According to Penck, the two slopes, both this the steeper as well as the gentler slope, both of them meet each other at a distinct angle, and this meeting of the two slopes is determined by the size of material that is to be moved and the amount of water available. So if you know the size of the material that is moved by a river, or that is moved by, you know, the runoff, and the water available in that particular runoff will actually determine the two different slopes. It is therefore, if the region is arid, where you have a lesser, you know, water availability, then the slope will become more steeper, whereas if it is a humid area, then the slope will be less steeper. So these are the basically slope concept of Penck. Penck has also given a concept of parallel retreat of slope, where he said that the retreat of gravity slope at constant angle represents what has come to be called as the principle of parallel retreat of slopes. So these are certain ideas of Penck on slopes, which was later on again analyzed and discussed by several geomorphologists and geologists. Now coming to the critical appraisal of what Penck has, what Penck's ideas of morphology. You know, Penck's model was criticized in US. He was a German, and he has based his most of his studies in the European continent, and he was also one of the major critic of Davisian concept of geomorphic cycle. But at the same time, his model was also criticized in the United States, and the scholars of the United States has criticized his model. Particularly, the criticism was on two front. One was on the parallel retreat of slope, and secondly, that there is a continued crustal movements. So these are the two points where the criticism was found to be more. Now, paying criticism was later on, many scholars have felt that since he wasn't there to explain his ideas, and also his writings were in a very difficult and typical German language. So therefore, later on, many of the scholars believed that his ideas were not fully understood by many of the scholars, and that is why many of the criticism was because of that also. And if we would have understood his ideas, his concept in a better way, and if he would have lived his life to make his concept clear to others, then we would not have been able to criticize him much. Now, after Penck, let me discuss about the geomorphic concept of L.C. King. L.C. King, you know, he has given a concept of geomorphic cycle, and in the beginning, let me tell you, his concept of geomorphic cycle was very much akin to what Davisian concept of geomorphic cycle was. So we have seen that Penck's ideas of geomorphic cycle was completely different from what Davis has given, but in the case of L.C. King, it was almost similar cycle. The only difference between the two was Davis has most of his, the observation or the most of his writing, most of the writings of Davis was in the case of the United States landscape observation, whereas L.C. King study or L.C. King observation was largely based in the African continent, and that too in the savanna regions of South Africa. So, his concept was largely on the arid concept of geomorphic cycle rather than humid, and he has given a number of other cycles like landscape cycle, epigene cycle, pediplanation cycle, hill slope cycle, etc. But as I said, his cyclical concept was more on the arid and semi-arid region, particularly of savanna regions of South Africa. Some of the postulates or some of the premises on which L.C. King built his theory was, firstly, he believed that there is a uniform development of landforms in varying environmental conditions. So whatever be the environmental conditions, the landform development is uniform in everywhere. Secondly, the second postulate of his theory was that there is insignificant influence of climatic changes in the development of fluvially originated landforms. So he doesn't believe that climatic changes has much significance in the development of fluvially originated landforms. Thirdly, he said that major landscapes in all the continents have been evolved by rhythmic global tectonic events. So according to him, landscapes formation in different continents is largely made up by rhythmic global tectonic events. And fourthly, there is a continuous, you know, migration of hill slope. So hill slope is not constant, it keeps on retreating continuously, and such retreat is always in the form of parallel retreat, which was also discussed by Walther Penck. So these are the four different postulata, or they are the four different premises on which L.C. King has built his theory. As I said, that his cycle of his geomorphical cycle was very much similar to Davisian, but his concept, since his concept of or his study was largely based in the arid region, so he has given a different terminology for his cycle, and he called his cyclical model of pediplanation. So in the case of Davis, we have seen the concept of peniplane, whereas L.C. King called it as a pediplane and he has discussed the cyclical model of pediplanation. He also believed that each cycle begins with a rapid rate of upliftment followed by long period of crustal stability. So Davis was also on the similar belief that there is a rapid rate of upliftment of the landmass in the beginning, after which there is no upliftment taking place and there is a long period of crustal stability during which the erosional process passes through three different phases of youth, mature and old. So this particular concept was taken by L.C. King, you can say as it is from Davis. Now he said that in the youth stage of his cyclic model of pediplanation, what happens that there is a rapid rate of downcutting by river consequent upon upliftment. So after upliftment, what happens that there is a very rapid rate of downcutting, there is a very rapid rate of valley incision, there is a formation of V-shaped valleys and the formation of gorges and canyons. So these are the land features which is characterized in the youth stage of his cyclic model of pediplanation. In the late youth stage, he says that interfloops are narrowed down. What happens as you progress in the different as you advance in the further stage, the interfluvial region are narrowed down. So in the beginning there is a larger interfluvial region, whereas later on you find lesser and a narrower interfluvial region, and this happens largely because of the continuous retreat of the slope. So as and when the slope is being retreated and goes backward, the interfluvial region declines, and it is the steep sided walls of is also becomes more moderate. In this particular phase, he said that there is a formation of Inselberg. Inselberg is a terminology in which he said that smaller steep sided hills are formed in this particular stage, and those steep sided hills are called as Inselberg, which is characterized in the youth stage of in the cycle of pediplanation. Rounded Inselberg, the steep sided hills are known as Inselberg, and if Inselbergs are rounded, it's not very steep sided, then it is called as Bornhards or castle copies. So these are the terminologies used by L.C. King in his theory, that if a hill is of a steep side, then this will be Inselberg, and if the sides are round or it is a rounded Inselberg, then these are called as Bornhards and castle copy or castle copies. In the mature stage, what happens? Mature stage is marked by absence of valley deepening. So in the youth stage, we have seen there is a continuous incision of incision by river, or it deepens the river, whereas in the mature stage it is almost absent. And lateral erosion starts. So what happens? The vertical erosion of the river valley stops and the lateral erosion of the river valley starts. So this is a characteristics of the mature stage, where the valley deepening or the incision of valley in a very steep sided manner stops and the lateral erosion of valley begins. In this particular stage, the Inselberg and castle copies also disappear. Thirdly, many pediments are materials transported by rivers. So those pediments, when they form together, they coalesce together, then a larger pediplane is formed. So when different or a number of pediments, several pediments coalesce together in order to form the pediplane, or what is also known as the uneven surface with low relief. So as we have seen in the case of pediplane, thus this is a complete featureless plane, whereas in the arid region what we find is pediplane, which is characterized by smooth, flatter surface but having number of pediments in it. Now in the third stage we have, which is also old stage, what we found is that residual hills almost disappear. So we do not find any hills and it becomes plain surface, which is also known as pediplain. So in the final stage you again find the similar kind of landforms as you have seen in the case of Davisian concept of geomorphic cycle or the Davisian concept of fluvial geomorphic cycle. So in the case of both the cycle of Davis as well as in L.C. King, what you find in the last stage is basically the featureless or the planned flat flat surface which is having no residual hills, having any features in that particular plain region. So this is what L.C. King called as pediplain. Now L.C. King has also given a concept of antique pediplanation, wherein he says that there are remnants of original pediplain. So when pediplains are formed, later on another cycle of erosion forms another pediplains, and similarly you have a several pediplains, and the earlier pediplains are buried inside and then they are preserved, and that particularly preserved pediplanation is also called as antique pediplanation. So the remnants of original pediplain developed during East cycle are preserved and exist on almost all summits. Now let us evaluate the cyclic concept given by L.C. King. As I have been discussing, that Davis and King both envisages the cyclical development of landforms, which was not in the case of Walther Penck. We have seen both cycle of Davis and King, what we found is ending with a peniplain and pediplain, which are a large flat surface or the large featureless flat surface. Here again we have seen that both cycles passes through the same youth, mature and old stage. And lastly, Davis peniplain is the result of downwesting, whereas pediplain is formed due to collisions and integration of several pediments formed due to parallel scarp retreat. So this is the basic difference between the peniplain and pediplain, that peniplain is formed largely because of the downwesting of the land mass, whereas pediplain is formed because of the collisions of several pediments together. So this is the basic difference between the Davisian concept of peniplain as well as the King's concept of pediplain. Davis peniplain, once formed does not experience further development unless it is rejuvenated, whereas pediplain once formed further grows headward. So this is another difference between the peniplain and pediplain, because in the case of Davis we have seen that peniplain once formed will not experience further development unless some rejuvenation process goes inside it, whereas pediplain is continuously formed one after another, and we have the instance of antique pediplanation. Now several of the scholars, geomorphologists and geologists have criticized L.C. King also, because his assertion that there is a uniform development in different uniform development of landform in different climatic situation is doubted by many scholars. Similarly, there is also a doubt doubt for antique pediplanation, and finally his theories came when geomorphologists have advanced themselves in the quantifying landform. So you see, L.C. King has given his concept somewhere during 1948, and immediately after that there was a greater a greater fashion, you can say, of quantifying different processes, different structural and lithological features of the landforms, and those quantification has not been, and those processes of quantifying landforms largely, you know, buried the concept of health seeking, and it was not appreciated much. Now this concept of penny plane, petty plane, pan plane, so it's a very confusing concept. So I have tried to put it together, and I have tried to explain, I'm going to try to explain these concepts one by one. One is penny plane. You all know that this particular penny plane is a Debussian concept, which is plane as perfect planation was not considered, almost plane as perfect planation was not considered to be reality. So why it is called as penny plane? Penny plane, it is called as penny plane because it is not a perfect plane, rather it is next to plane, or you can say it is almost a plane. So that is why it is called as penny plane. You know, Douglas Johnson, a famous geomorphologist, has given a different spelling to this particular concept, which is he called it as a penny plane, but he spelled it differently. Now in the case of pediments, you know what is pediments? Pediments are rock float plains adjacent to or interpreting mountain masses in desert regions. As I discussed, that's a rock float plains at the, you know, bottom of the mountain masses in desert regions, particularly you will find this, and these have been developed by the planation of the mountains at altitudes dependent upon those of the interior basins into which the mountain drains. So these are the, you know, smaller mountain masses which is, you know, spread at the floor of the mountains, and once these petty plains are coalesced together, then the formation of the petty plains takes place. There was another concept given by Kricme in 1933, which is of pan plane. What is this pan plane? Pan plane is again a plain formed by flood plains joined by their own growth. So when a flood plain keeps spreading and spreading, and when it is merging with the other flood plains, the nearby flood plains, and it is making up larger flood plains, then it is called as pan plains. This concept was given by Kricme in 1933. There was again another concept of edge plains. Welland, in 1934, while studying his while doing his analysis in Uganda in Africa, he said that there is also an edge plane, which is the surface below penny plane has been formed by a process called etching, and hence named as. So this particular edge plane is found at the bottom of the penny plane, and it is formed by the etching process, and that is why it is called as edge planes. Now coming to the third and very important theory, which is of dynamic equilibrium theory. This is, you can say, more very recent theory. This particular theory was given by J.T. Haack, which was who was a US geomorphologist, and his study was largely in the Appalachian Highlands of the United States. Scholars, geomorphologists, and geologists have said that J.T. Haack's ideas of dynamic equilibrium theory is very much matching with the Gilbert's ideas. Now, what is this dynamic equilibrium theory? Dynamic equilibrium theory, according to J.T. Haack, is the changes in topographic form takes place as equilibrium conditions change, but no particular cycle occurs. So the concept of J.T. Haack in his dynamic equilibrium theory is not a cyclical concept, rather it is a continuous concept. So a cyclical concept given by Davis is also called as closed system, whereas the dynamic equilibrium theory is also called as open system, because there is a continuous process of, you know, upliftment and rate of erosion, and the, you know, the ratio between the two, the rate of upliftment and the rate of erosion, there will be dynamic equilibrium among the two processes. So this is what JT has tried to put forward in his dynamic equilibrium theory. He said that delicate condition of energy balance is there in the, you know, formation of the landforms, and he envisaged that so long as the factors controlling landscape development and denudational processes and energy in the open geomorphic system remain constant, there is no appreciable change in the landform through time. So landform will only be formed when there will be disturbance in the equilibrium or dynamic equilibrium, and the moment there will be disturbance in the dynamic equilibrium theory, then this landform landform development takes place. Whereas when the landform development takes place, the rate of erosion and the rate of upliftment of the landmass, there will be a constant equilibrium processes that will take place. Now ideally this particular equilibrium condition in reality doesn't exist, but nevertheless after Davis there was no such concept as important as dynamic equilibrium theory, because it explains that whenever there is a multi-level landscapes, it can only be explained with the help of multiple erosion cycle, and it cannot be, with the help of multiple erosion cycle, and it needs to be understood with the help of the dynamic equilibrium theory. So this particular, we have discussed earlier also that there are only very few landscapes which are which is very simple landscapes. Most of the landscapes are complex, and since the landscapes are complex, we cannot, you know, define it. We cannot put a model for the complex landforms in the way of a simple cyclic theory of Davis. So in that particular situation, this dynamic dynamic equilibrium theory is very important. Now this particular dynamic equilibrium theory suggests that geomorphic system is an open system, and so long as energy remains constant in the geomorphic system, landscapes remain in the condition of steady state, though there is lowering in the landscape by denudational processes. Now this is also a time independent development of landscapes. We have seen Davis was a time dependent landscape development, whereas here we have seen that it is a time independent development of landscapes. Finally, lithological adjustment to landforms. There are certain this lithological adjustment is continuously going on, wherein topographic forms and processes are closely related to the differences in the rocks and processes acting on them. To understand this dynamic, or to make this dynamic equilibrium theory, J.T. Hacks had made certain assumptions, and these assumptions are that there is a balance between the denudational processes and rock resistance. So as long as this balance is there, the landform development will not take place. But the moment there is uniform rate of downwesting in all components of landscapes, and thirdly, differences and characteristics of form are explicable in terms of spatial relations in which geological patterns are primary considerations. So these are the three different Hacks assumptions on which he has put forward his dynamic equilibrium theory. Now what is his dynamic equilibrium theory? He said the rate of upliftment is balanced with the rate of erosion. So whenever there is a rate of upliftment, if it is increasing, similarly there will be an increase in the rate of erosion. The moment the rate of upliftment will decrease, the rate of erosion will also decrease. So this particular increase and decrease according to the upliftment of the landmass and in the, you know, rate of erosion, this particular adjustment is known as equilibrium condition. So the theory says that so long as the rate of upliftment increases, the relief also increases. When there is a rapid rate of upliftment,
then at that particular point of time there will be rapid rate of erosion also, and at that and as a consequence of that, what happens, there will be relief will also increase. Vice versa, when there will be the when the rate of upliftment will slow down and the rate of erosion will also slow down, the increase in the relief will also decline, and finally there will come a situation when there will be an equilibrium between both the rate of upliftment of land mass as well as rate of rate of erosion. So when this particular condition is made, when the rate of upliftment of land mass and the rate of erosion both are almost similar, then that particular situation is called as equilibrium condition, which is very rare to find in the real circumstances. The evolutionary models, these evolutionary models can be conceived on the basis of base level of erosion. Now, what is this base level of erosion? Base level of erosion is the erosion up to the base level. We know that any river only erodes up to the sea level and it doesn't erode beyond that. And that is what is known as the base level erosion. Now there are three distinct, you know, pattern in this base level erosion. These three distinct pattern is one is stable base level, where the land mass is uplifted and then remains stable for a long geological period, and then land mass is eroded down and lower to base level of erosion, thus the change of land. So this is a stable base level. But there are two other circumstances when there is a rise in the base level and when there is a fall in the base level. So suppose if the base level rises because of the positive change in the sea level. Now base level rise in the base level happens because of the positive change in the sea level. That means the sea level increases, and when the sea level increases, because of that the base level decreases, and in that particular circumstances what happens, the lower segment of the river is submerged due to transgression of seawater on coastal land, but there is no appreciable effect of base level change on the upstream segment on the stream. Whereas when there is a fall in the base level, which largely happens because of the decline in the crustal movement, then the rapid rate of erosion in the downstream section is observed. Finally, let me put an evaluation of J.T. Haack's concept. You know, as I said earlier, that Davis has given his concept, which was a closed system, whereas Haack's was an open system. So there is a continuous process between the rise, you know, the rate of upliftment of land mass and the rate of erosion. So it is an open system, it is not a closed system, and it is a continuous process rather than a cycle bound process. Secondly, it does not appreciate the historical interpretation of landforms. So in the case of Haack's, you can only explain the outer topography or the outer landscape, whereas if you want to explain the if you want to present a historical interpretation of the landscape, it will be very difficult to do with the help of the dynamic equilibrium theory. And with this I will end. If there are certain questions, or if the time permits, then I will just conclude.
Yes sir, we have almost 5 minutes left. My question is, although no concept or no cycle or no theory in itself contradictory to another, but what do you think, whose cycle is the most appropriate?
Actually, the concept is not a very rigid, the theory building is not one time process, it keeps on developing, because as and when time passes, there are many factors taken into account. And as I have mentioned earlier also, that this these cycles or these concepts or these theories are basically trying to explain for a very smaller region. So every scholar does his research in a smaller region, and he tries to present his concept in and which is applicable for that particular region. But till date, there is no concept, no theory which is applicable for the entire world or the entire landscape which is present on the globe. So therefore, there are two things in it. One, that the concept or the theories, they are very much, you know, time as well as region specific. And secondly, this is a continuous process by which we keep on building our theories and concepts, because every now and then their new knowledge comes in, new factors comes in, and then we try to accommodate those factors and knowledge into the concept of geomorphic cycle.
When we talk about the topic geomorphology, it is very clear that we are talking about the outer surface of the earth, basically. But if we go deep down inside the earth, then the concept changes and we says that it is geology. Do you think that the internal, all the, if any internal vibrations or any internal things which go inside affects the outer surface?
Of course it does. Of course it does. Most of the landforms that we see out, see on the outcrop of the land surface is largely, as I have been discussing, in most of the cycle we have seen that it is a continuous process of, you know, upliftment of the landmass and the rate of erosion. So upliftment of landmass is nothing but the crustal the inner, you know, inner surface of the land, the earth, which goes under several diastrophic movements. There we have, you know, volcanoes, we have plate tectonics. So all those things are there, which leads to the, you know, upliftment of the landmass. There is also submergence and emergence of the landmass. So these upliftment of the landmass is largely happening because of the inner surface of the, or the, you know, inner part of the earth surface. And outer landform, what we see is the outcome of the competition between the, you know, uplifted landmass as well as the erosion processes that is happening on that uplifted landmass. So as and when the rate of erosion or the process of erosion is taking place in those uplifted landmass, what we see outside is the result of that particular competition.
This is the thing of we asked about the internal and the outer, but if you talk about the outer perspective only, that is about the geomorphic concept only. Do you think the way that our cycle, this cycle keeps on changing, and with the change of the cycle, does it has any effect on the environment?
Okay, actually, cycle, you know, there as I have discussed earlier, there are very few landscapes in the world which is of a simple cycle. There are very few landscapes, and most of the landscapes are very complex. So since the landscapes are complex, that means it is not made up of one cycle, it is made up of more than one cycle. And these processes are basically a very balancing processes.
From this, I can well interpret that how it affects or not affects the environment. We have very, very less time left with us. Thank you so very much, Dr. Abhay Kumar, for delivering such a nice lecture and bringing out the new concepts as well as the various geomorphic cycles. Thank you so very much for being with us.
Thank you very much. Thank you.